Good afternoon. Thank you for coming to this presentation of the Korea semester. Dr. Michael Garoutte, Professor of Chemistry. Michael was on the Korea semester planning committee, and I appreciated the fact that almost immediately he volunteered to give a presentation on South Korean adoptions, and the committee was all in favor of that. It's really tremendous when our own faculty will be presenters for the theme semester. And so we certainly appreciate Michael for volunteering and putting together this presentation. He's been on the faculty here at Missouri Southern for 20 years now. Can you believe that? Remember the day he started. He's held a number of important positions on campus also. And he's going to tell you about a firsthand experience with South Korean adoptions. His youngest daughter, who's now 12, was adopted from South Korea when she was 6 months. So without further ado, let's give a warm, hearty Missouri Southern welcome to Dr. Michael Garoutte.
Thanks, Jen. Well, thank you for that welcome. This is a different kind of presentation than I would normally give as a professor of chemistry. But this is my academic title, International Adoptions Since the 1950s. I have a subtitle for this presentation. This is my subtitle. This isn't the one I gave to Dr. Stebbins, but so in this presentation, I hope to show, you know, some of the academic side, but also some of the personal side of the story. I'm going to start with the history. So international adoption wasn't a thing until after the Korean conflict. And so when the Korean War ends, although it's not, as we know, it's not technically over, but when the fighting ceased and the truce was signed, a gentleman named Harry Holt and his wife viewed a video produced by World Vision depicting the plight of what they called at that time war orphans. So these are the war orphans in South Korea. Harry was a logger and a farmer. They already had 6 kids, but they saw the plight of these children and decided that something had to be done. Harry had already had a heart attack and nearly died, and had basically devoted himself to God and said, whatever you want from me, I'm there for you, and this seemed to be the thing that God wanted for him to do. So on a plane he gets and goes to South Korea. So Harry goes to South Korea and leaves his wife Bertha at home to lobby Congress to change the law to allow them to adopt children and bring them home. There was no such thing as intra-country adoption in 1955, and so there were no laws allowing that or figuring out how to deal with that. So Bertha, his wife, lobbying Congress, gets a bill passed through Congress in a very short period. Eisenhower signs the bill. It's called a Bill for Relief of Certain War Orphans in 1955. And Harry comes back on a plane with 8 kids. And they adopt 8 kids. So their family has increased in size from 8 to 16. In 1956, so a year later, Harry goes back to Korea because, you know, 8 is kind of the limit. That's as many as they could adopt, but there were a lot more children that needed assistance. And so he goes back to Korea and starts an orphanage. And this is the very beginnings of Holt International Children's Services, which exists to this day as an organization that functions in lots of countries to help kids in places where it's needed. They continue to try to support the orphans who are now the adopted kids in the United States. In 1957, they had their first picnic. And so the families would come to their, I think it, the first time was at their home in Oregon, and they had 300 families at that very first picnic in 1957. This lady is Harry's daughter, Molly Holt, who actually is next to him. This is the staff of the first orphanage that opened there in Seoul in 1955. And he recruited this man, David Kim, and so together, the three of them basically built this from the ground up. And as you'll see during my presentation, the Holt family, the Holt organization, and also the Korean government just kind of leapfrogged each other in terms of ideas about how to build a system. The country didn't really have a system to take care of children that were outside of the family unit. This is Molly, who continued to work for her entire life. In 1961, in Islan, they built a long-term care facility. So there were plenty of children who were not getting adopted because they had special needs. They didn't think that adoption was a very likely possibility for them, and so they built a long-term care facility. And so now they have orphanages and homes for children in Korea. In 1964, in Korea, Harry Holt passes away, leaving his wife with the 14 children. And she does not give up. She takes over the organization and continues the mission. And in 1966, she is recognized as the American Mother of the Year. Here is a picture of her with Hubert Humphrey, who was then the vice president, accepting her award as Mother of the Year in 1966. So that's the origins of the international adoption in Korea. My subtitle was sort of three generations of adopted kids. I don't have three generations of adopted kids in my personal family. I only have two. So I'm going to start with the first generation, and that's going to be the story of Susan Cox. Susan Cox was the child of a Korean soldier and, or an American soldier and a Korean mother, as many of the first generation of the adoptees were. She tells the story that Harry Holt himself took her from the orphanage that could no longer take her to his orphanage, and she was the 167th child to be adopted from Korea through this organization. She was adopted at age 4 and a half. And you don't have to memorize these details, but I'm going to draw some parallels to this story, to some of the stories that happened in my own family as I go along through the talk. She was adopted by, you can see at the top there, Marvin and Jane Gurley. They also had children already, and later on they adopted another child from Korea. And so they ended up with quite a large family as well. At age 6, she became a United States citizen. She says, and you know, in my research, I read a lot of things that Susan wrote. She says that she just tried to fit in. If you look differently from everyone around you, she said, you don't have to behave any differently to be distinctive. She says, I've seen that much more as a positive than a negative. And her family was probably had something to do with that. They made it very clear from the beginning that they treasured her Korean heritage. They didn't know much of it, but they did the best they could to make her feel that she was special. And that seems to have been successful because when she grew up, she went to work for the agency. So in 1978, she joins the board of Holt Children's Services. She visits Korea. At this time, she did not have any desire to meet her birth parents. This time she felt like meeting your birth parents was only for adopted children who were unhappy in their situations for whatever reason. By the mid-80s, the sort of views had changed, and so it became more accepted to seek out your birth parents just to find out about your history, even if you didn't have any particular reason that you, you know, were unhappy in your adopted life. She actually joined the Holt staff in 1983, and as she was going through this, she posted a small ad in a newspaper in Seoul, just saying what her name was, and let's see, she had her passport photo, and what time she had left for America, and she wasn't able to find her birth mother right at that time. But eventually someone came forward. It turns out that her birth mother had just passed away, but she did meet the people who would have been her half-brothers and talk to them. One of the things that she found out at this time was that her birth mother had given her this name, Sun Kum, which translated means pure gold. And her half-brother told her the story that on her deathbed, her birth mother had told her half-brother about the sister that she had that went to America, and that her name was pure gold. She is still with Holt International and is currently one of the vice presidents at Holt. So that's a little bit about the first generation of Korean adoptees. Now I'm going to go to the second one. So 1974. This one is a little bit closer to me. This one, Susan Caroline Mazur, was adopted by Mark and Carolyn Mazur. Here's her picture. So it turns out her parents were on vacation, visiting some family. They picked up a Sunday paper. They didn't have a time to look at the Sunday paper, so they stuck it in the back seat of the car. And when they got home and unpacked and finally things settled down, they had a chance to look at the paper, and in there was an insert, as there still are, but this insert was showing these kids in Korea who needed homes. And they felt moved to reach out and adopt one of them. And that at the time, the process just didn't take that long. From that day that they looked at it, it was less than a year. It was like 8 months to the day that Susan arrived in Kansas City. Turns out that she was left outside a police station by, we're not exactly sure, her Korean parents. This is not or was not atypical at the time. It was kind of acceptable in society. If you were going to abandon a child, there were safe places you could abandon a child. Even today, there are baby boxes where you can leave a child and know that it will be taken care of. I'll talk a little bit more about that part of it later on. This is the first picture that they have of her when she arrived. She arrived escorted by a Mrs. Feehan. They have her name. But this was also very common. So an escort would bring over anywhere from 6 to 10 Korean kids to the United States who had already been matched up with families. And so here's Susan with her escort, and all of her earthly possessions are in this photo at that time. So this outfit and this little silk purse, which is filled with some little trinkets, were the only things that she had to her name at this time. This was her family immediately after that, and this is Mark and Carolyn. These are her three brothers and sisters. So she was the fourth and the youngest. Much like Susan Cox, she adapted very quickly. She was naturalized on March 8, 1978. And if you can imagine a bunch of third graders in a courtroom with her 26 classmates and her 20 brownie troop mates all there to witness 30-some people taking the naturalization oath from, I think, 16 different countries, and she was one of those. So she gets in the newspaper, of course, because there's certainly the largest amount of spectators there to witness that. 9-year-old Susan Caroline Mazur had more friends attending than any of the new citizens. Yeah. And there she is in the courtroom with her certificate, and I don't know what this is. Maybe it's a constitution. I don't know what that is. So much like the Coxes, much like the Gurley family, they didn't know much of Korean history, but they treasured it and tried to find out what they could and pass that along. So some things that are similar in those first and second generations. Both of both Susans were brought into a white family in a small town. See if you can pick out which student doesn't belong in this photo. Nevertheless, they were successful. So, you know, it's challenging to be the one non-white person in a small town. You generally attract a lot of attention. Both of them spoke only Korean when they arrived, and they were both old enough to speak, so they only spoke Korean. This was in Susan's scrapbook. Their parents didn't obviously speak Korean or read it because this label is upside down. But these are the bracelets that were on her wrist, identifying her and where she was going to be placed so that she didn't get with the wrong people. This was some kind of wrapper of some kind of cake or treat that she had on the plane on the way over. So she adapted really quickly. Neither of them remembers much of their time in Korea. Those memories faded quickly. Susan would tell stories of her two dads. One of them might have been a bus driver. She remembers having soup with fish eyes in it. There's just little snippets of memories here and there, but just not very much. But she adapted really quickly to life in the United States, and here she is in, I forget what that picture is, so we'll move on to the next thing. Her family, just like the Coxes, did try to make it clear that they felt that she was special being adopted from Korea. They never made that a secret. Here she is in a traditional Korean outfit, which I'm not sure where it came from because it certainly wasn't part of her possessions. I asked her sister before the talk, and they figured that her mom must have bought this from Holt. They did sell those kinds of things, so that must have been the occasion. She still has the same little silk purse there. And we still have that. And every year on the anniversary of her arrival, so that would have been May 3rd, her parents, they tried to learn some words in Korean. They learned them from Susan, who only spoke Korean. The first night that she was at her parents' home, she sang a little Korean song to her Raggedy Ann doll at night. She, her parents learned the words for mother and father. They learned nabi for butterfly, and they learned, the way they pronounced was pyeonggi for airplane. And this is the day, so we still celebrate pyeonggi day in our household. So I did learn last year that it's very difficult to put paint on an ice cream cake, but it is in fact possible. And you can in fact put the Hangul for pyeonggi onto a cake and make that work out. So now a little bit of the academic side of the talk. In the 1960s, so beginning right in 1955 and carrying through the 1960s, there were Korean adoptions to the United States. So this slide is actually talking about total adoptions from South Korea. The vast majority of those were to the United States. Later on, some other countries were a fraction of those, mostly Northern European, Scandinavian countries. But the vast majority of them are to the United States. These continue along in the 60s at a few hundred a year. So these would be what were in that original bill is what are called the war orphans. In the 60s is, again, when Holt built the long-term care facilities in Korea. In 1964, the government established Korea's social services, so they didn't really have that until 1964. In April of 1965, Holt started a foster home project. So foster parenting in Korea wasn't a thing before 1965. That was started also by Holt, taken over later by the government. In the 1970s, so Korea was kind of in a post-war recession in the 1970s, and the foreign aid that had been coming in to help with the rebuilding was drying up. And so therefore, the funding from the government for social services was also drying up. and the amount, the number of children adopted abroad just went up dramatically. Over 6,000 a year we're doing in the 1970s. And that led up to, I mean, that kind of continued in the 1970s. I'll also mention the Vietnam War happened during this time. And so following kind of the model of the Korean adoptions, this also started happening to some Vietnamese children at the time. But we're still thinking of them as war orphans, even though in the 1970s, most of these children are no longer war orphans. They're just kids of single moms who find themselves in a position that they can't take care of a child. In the 1980s, it's even higher. And what happens in 1980s is that the world attention is brought to Korea because of the Seoul Olympics in 1988. And so parents, some of them of these first generation visiting Korea with their families, seeing what's going on, they're on the world stage. And from many of the sources that I read, the country is just embarrassed by this statistic. Stories are being written that maybe, you know, Korea's largest export is babies, and that $5,000 a head, which people are paying to the orphanages in their adoption fees, is like a natural resource that they're exporting. It's really, it puts bad publicity on the Republic of Korea. And so in 1987, the Korean government sets quotas on how many students or how many babies, children, can be adopted out of the country. With a decrease of 5 to 10% a year with the goal of totally eliminating them by something like 1997. In 1989, the first domestic adoption agency is started. So for, 30 years, there's been no domestic adoption agencies. So there's really been no other opportunity for these children. In 1989, and that started by Holt also, the Holt Family Child Adoption Center. So the quotas begin to take effect. The numbers decrease. And in the 90s, there's another economic crisis. Korea gets put under the supervision of the IMF. They decide that the quotas are not, you know, or they have more need in orphanages than they can now account for, and so they lift the quotas. And so the number stabilizes out in the couple of thousands there for a while. What happens during this period is that 40% of these adoptions are actually now children with special needs. So those are much harder to place, especially domestically, and so a large fraction of those that are placed internationally are special needs children. And then you'll notice until the present that there is a decline in international or intercountry adoptions. As I'll talk about in a little bit, the domestic adoptions really haven't kept pace with that. And I'll talk a little bit about why. So it was fun getting this data. You can find some of this data from the State Department and the US government. And then the other data I have to find on Korean sites. I don't read Korean, so I used a lot of Google Translate and tried really hard, but that was fun getting this data. This slide is now showing the green bar is the Korean. So that's actually the same data as this data, but now with all of the other countries on top of that. So the total intra-country adoptions from other countries. By the 2000s, we have a lot of countries that are going through the same process you see. An increase in intra-country adoptions and then later a decrease until the present. Right now, well, this is not totally current, but take my word for it, South Korea is not anywhere close to the largest exporter of children. There are lots of other countries that are in that position. This slide is showing what happens with the light blue bars are the intercountry adoptions. The dark blue bars are the domestic in Korea adoptions. So they're not keeping pace. And I'll talk about a couple of the reasons for that. As many of the Asian countries are, the Korean culture is very patrilineal. So the bloodline is very important. The bloodline is referred to, yes, I don't see it in my notes. So anyway, it's extremely important. And as long as the parents have their, quote, pure Korean blood, their Koreanness is passed along the family line. And there's a system of registries called the Jokbo, which go back several centuries in many cases with your family lineage. And your sort of status in society is tied to that. So if one is without a father, if one is a child of a single mother, then one doesn't have that status in society. So it's difficult to then convince families to adopt a child that they feel like is going to have no status in their society. And so many of these children that do not get adopted internationally or domestically end up becoming adults while still in the orphanage and then have not much chance of employment outside of factories or low-level jobs. In 2007, the Korean government, you know, they realized this problem. They're making incentives to try to promote domestic adoption. They're doing things like giving official government status to adopted children as if they were biological children. And then this slide shows that the total adoptions are decreasing. That's kind of the same data as this one, but it just a little bit goes up to a little bit more of the current day. So from 2000, when we had 4,000 or so, now down to about 1,000. So it seems to be somewhat successful, although what will I say? Time will tell. Like at this point, I couldn't testify as to whether these are actually meeting the need or whether it's just the restrictions in the, you know, in the policies that are causing the decrease in the adoptions. In 2012, the Koreans passed the revised Special Adoption Act, which adds a one-week waiting period for birth mothers to before they are allowed to sort of give up their child for adoption, so they have a waiting period. They've increased support for the adoptive families. They've strengthened screening, so they check for criminal records. They require the adoptive parents to attend classes, child care classes, before they adopt. So they're really trying to bring up the social support in the country now. So why do I have that little red bar there? Because this is sort of the end of my academic part of the talk, and I'm going to go back to the part that I'm really familiar with, which is the third generation of Korean adoptees, and that one is this red bar here. Before I do that, I should acknowledge that my perspective is very positive, and I'm relating that very positive perspective. That's not shared by 100%. There is a very small fraction of Korean adoptees who are pretty vocally unhappy with the fact that they've been taken away from their birth country. At this time, that over 200,000 Koreans have been adopted internationally, 200,000. About 500 of them, so that's like 0.25%, have returned to Korea and sort of are in a community of people who are trying to make themselves extinct, as they put it. And they're also trying to help bring Korean culture to be more accepting. It's still not accepted in Korean culture to be a single-parent family. Non-traditional families are just not acceptable. There's this group that is called this particular group is promoting this event called the Single Mother's Day to raise awareness of that in society. This is the fifth year that they have done that event. And one of the organizers of this event, who is this lady, was herself an inter-country adoptee who's gone back to Korea. And she says that choosing to raise a son alone in this tradition-bound society means a social stigma, that her family cut off all ties with her. She has not been able to restore ties with her family. She is unable to get a decent job. She gets harassed at work. All of these things because she's a single parent. In the 2000s, 9 out of 10 kids who are given up for adoption are children of single mothers in Korea. And that social stigma is just too much for most of them to overcome. Even today, the financial support for adoptive families in Korea is more than the financial support for single mothers. So the system has made strides, but it's still not fully supporting the needs of the country. But I said that the subtitle of this talk was about a love story, so let's get to that part. So 2006. Madeline Juyun Garoutte was adopted by Michael and Susan Garoutte. That would be my wife and myself. We always knew we wanted to adopt a child from Korea. Susan was adopted from Korea. She wanted to pay it forward. I always knew that was part of the bargain in marrying her, and I was 100% in support of that. And it doesn't take 3 or 8 months now to adopt a child from any foreign country or probably domestically. It takes a lot longer than that. It took probably a year before we got this one photograph of our placement. And so I won't forget, I made a list of all the sorts of things we had to do. Fill out lengthy questionnaires. We had to have multiple background checks, fingerprinting, physical exams. We had to have letters of reference, multiple home studies by a social worker. We had to submit several years of tax returns, and we had to travel both to Jefferson City and to Kansas City to the USCIS on multiple occasions in order to get cleared to get this placement. So on September 8th of 2005, we got a referral, and this is all the information we have, plus a little bit of tiny biographical data, like the parent is this age and the other parent is this age and one of them smoked, and that's all we know about them. So then we wait. So we'd waited a year to get to this point, and now we wait some more, and then on Christmas Eve, we get what is referred to as the travel call. Both of the Susans I talked about earlier were escorted, but we didn't want to do that. This was our chance to visit, it was our only chance to see where Madeline had spent the first 6 months of her life. And we weren't going to pass that up. Wow, it was tough. So first of all, once you get that travel call, you have 2 weeks to be in the country. So we're making travel arrangements. It's cold in Korea. It's just like here. It's winter time. We get there on a Friday night. Do not arrive in a foreign country where you don't speak the language and you're expecting a driver on a Friday night, because when they don't show up, everybody's gone home for the weekend. So we're in the airport for I don't know how long, just basically freaking out and saying, well, and at some point we say, well, maybe we should just get a taxi. At which point is when we discover that the Korean word for taxi is taxi. That's a good thing, right? Because someone says, you need a taxi? I'm like, oh, thank you. It's an hour from the airport in Incheon to Seoul. So we have to get a taxi, go an hour. We have like a little 3x5 card with an address in Hangul, which we can't read. We went to like 4 different places in a strange city of millions of people. Anyway, we eventually arrive here. It's dark. It's 9 o'clock at night. It's dark. This is a guest house that Holt keeps. It's actually the old guest house, which we requested. There's a newer one in the orphanage, but we heard that it was noisy and bustling, and this is the old one, and it's quiet, and that's what we wanted, but it turned out to be awfully hard to find, even when you have a little 3x5 card with the address on it. Nevertheless, there we are. And while we are there, There's a nice Windows 98 computer in the little state. We figure out how to use it. It's also in Korean. But luckily, the start button's in the same place, so we figure out how to use it. And I find out I have an email. And we get the second photograph of Madeline. So it doesn't actually come until we're already in Korea. We get a second photograph. And this is it. So we have time to do sightseeing. Why now? Because if you're going to do the sightseeing, you have to do it first, because once they place you with the child, they want you out of the country. So you've got to do your sightseeing first. So just as a preview, we do get to meet Madeline, right? We do get to meet her. But before that, we're going to try to soak up as much of the culture as we can. So here we go, trying to soak up some culture. This is the guest house. There's a picture of Harry Holt in the guest house. This is the water cooler, which we were told to drink that water because the tap water wasn't really good for drinking. We got addicted to that, so we have one of these. It has hot and cold, so you can make your hot tea or your cold. We have one of those at home now, and we have ever since then. You can see by the door here, it's traditional to take off one's shoes and put on slippers, and so there's a little container to put your shoes and put slippers on, and of course they provided slippers for you. I don't think they were expecting size 14 Americans, but nevertheless, that's provided. The heating is the traditional Ondal heating, so the heating is into the floors. It's like a radiator in the floor. So all these floors are, the heat comes from the floor, which is really cool until you forget that that's the case and you put your sack of candy on the floor that you were going to bring home and give to people. And now it's one melted solid chunk of mess. This was our bathroom. If you can see, that is the shower head, right there next to the sink and the toilet. And it's under the stairs. So this is probably about 5 feet tall. So you can imagine how difficult that was for a person like me to actually get in there and take a shower. Also, we were told not to flush the toilet paper because the sewers couldn't handle that. So that meant there was a little container for that too. So it didn't really smell good in there. We're soaking up the culture. In the subways, there are these places that make hot food, and these little hot foods are like little custard donut things, little round, that they have a machine making those things right here. They're called delimenju, and then we have to have those, right? They come by the half a dozen or the dozen. When we got the travel call and we rushed to the airport, we left we took our three-year-old daughter with us to Korea. We left her coat in the car. So the first thing we have to do is find a shopping mall and buy her a coat. So I don't have time to tell you about that adventure, but we did. We went to church. We found the International Lutheran Church. Its services were in English. We met some people who spoke English, taught at a middle school, gave us some pointers about where to shop for things. We found the Holt headquarters, which was pretty close to where we were staying. We visited the markets. We had street food. The shopping malls had food in the same court with the GNC. Yeah. We went to bookstores. Recognize any? Anybody know Rainbow Fish? Oh, David? Goodnight Moon? We saw the changing of the guard. Yes, they have the changing of the guard in Seoul. I don't have time to tell you about that either. And we had more street food. We got a guide. They hooked us up with a high school graduate who showed us the city, and we got to have a traditional Korean meal. And we saw palaces. And we saw more palaces. And more palaces. We went on the subway. I'm glad we did. This is the only time we actually got out of the city, so you could actually see the city from a distance. A three-year-old American girl gets lots of attention on the subway. They will just take care, every small child, every other person feels like they need to parent that small child. So they're always pulling up her socks because it's cold, or pulling down her pants, or making sure that she's, taken care of, taking selfies and showing them on their cell phones. Instant friends all the time. And then we met Madeline. All right, so. Oh, I just wanted to pause that. Oh well, I will talk over it. So this is a wellness check. There's a doctor. There's Madeline. This is the foster mother. What you cannot tell in this picture is how emotional the foster mother is. You can tell close to the end.
Hi.
You can really tell when, and I don't think I noticed at the time, but she's just torn up. We found out later that this family, this was the sixth child that they had fostered, that they knew would be given up for adoption. And since this is a love story, I'm going to show you how much that Madeline was loved before she ever came home to her family. She had a foster mother, a foster father, a foster sister, who of course makes friends with my biological daughter immediately. And so does the foster dad. They provided us with a photo book showing the first 6 months of her life, because they knew that that is all we were going to have. So the foster mother knitted her this cap, which we have still. Foster brother, foster cousins, my favorite. The 100th day celebration is a big thing in Korean culture, because historically, many children didn't live to their 100th day, so if they did, it was a good sign they were probably going to make it. It's called Baekil, and it was celebrated on the 100th day, and you can see the special food and the special cake that they did this for her and took pictures. And not only that, but they gave us the traditional dress as well. It's called a hanbok, with photographs of how to put on. In order. And so we did, of course, because on your first birthday, you're supposed to wear that. When Madeline comes to this country, she is immediately part of an extended family of cousins, many of them who are also adopted from other countries. She was adopted on April 20-something, 2006, April 27th. And on her first birthday, we all dressed up. Well, I didn't. They all dressed up in their Korean dress with her traditional first-year Korean birthday party with japchae, bulgogi, and kimchi. Participated in the Doljabi event, where the child picks up an object, and which object that she picks will tell you about what her life is going to be like. She picked the thread, so that means she's going to have a long life. She did not pick the bow and arrow, which would have meant she was a warrior. You're supposed to put that at the back if you don't want her to pick that one. Okay, so I'm going to take the last 4 minutes to do this. If you have to go, I understand.
is real. Real is love. Love is feeling. Feeling love. Love is wanting.
Those are traditional Korean face masks.
Love is needed to be loved. Love is you, you and me. Love is wanting. To be free. Love is knowing we will be.
That's it.